2 minutes and give you brief on the Indian Overseas Congress. We are in about 25 countries, lots and lots of members all over. And as a normal interactions, we go visit many of these countries. Mr. Gandhi and I started our first visit in the US about 18 months ago, had many interactions as part of a package with political leaders, think tanks, academicians, NRI business leaders, students, and members of the Indian Overseas Congress. In the US, we spent almost a week. Then later on, we went to Bahrain because of the Gopio Conference. Then we spent some time in Singapore, Malaysia, London, Berlin, and now we are here. We recognize the value of NRI community here in UAE. We respect the accomplishments and the wealth they have generated, not just for themselves, but also for the country. We are here to understand a little more about them and how we can benefit from them back home. We had 2 full days, met lots of interesting people. The reception has been exceptional. Hospitality has been superb. And we are thankful to everyone here, mainly the government, political bosses, officers, and the Indian community at large. We have learned a few interesting things, and Mr. Gandhi challenged us to have more interactions with the NRI communities here in Dubai from all over the world to discuss input required for the Congress Party manifesto. This is an important initiative which will take place here with the help of Indian community in UAE, where we'll invite people from all over the world. And hopefully, this will strengthen our ties in the future. We look forward to working with the community here, with the government here, because this is very close in proximity to excitements going on in India. Indian Overseas Congress members are becoming more active in the Indian elections. One, by participating in social media to promote our idea of India, our messages. Two, some people go back and work with the local candidates during election time. Three, they in particular support one candidate in one state or their village and become more and more active. We recognize the role of social media. I don't know if you all have an opportunity to see social media on which Rahul Gandhi participates. Facebook page, Twitter, website. I strongly recommend you to go visit, not just tonight, but on a regular basis, maybe once a day, to see what's happening with Rahul Gandhi. You will learn a lot, and I'm sure you will get to understand our perspective much better. With this, I want to welcome Congress President Mr. Rahul Gandhi to come here and say a few words and then open up for a conversation with you. Thank you.
Good evening and thank you for coming here. I want to start this press conference by thanking the entire Indian community, the leadership of the UAE, the leadership of Dubai, for the love and affection that has been shown to me. Please feel free to ask me whatever questions you'd like. If you ask me in English, I'll respond in English. If you ask me in Hindi, I'll respond in Hindi.
But if you ask in Arabic, we'll have problems.
We'll try to answer that as well. Well, the BSP and the SP have every right to have an alliance. I think the Congress party has a tremendous amount to offer the people of Uttar Pradesh. So we will obviously do our best as the Congress party. We will fight for our ideology, and I think we might give a surprise or two to people about what the Congress party is capable of doing and how the Congress party can mobilize in Uttar Pradesh. Of course, I have tremendous respect for Mayawati ji, for Mulayam Singh Yadav ji, for Akhilesh ji, and they are open to do what they choose. We will obviously fight the election in UP.
Ms. Gandhi.
Sorry?
A woman not being able to defend him in two and a half hours.
No, that's not what I said. What I said was that the Prime Minister...
Could I just ask you my question?
Yeah,
just, would you think that you have lost a woman's vote because of these remarks?
No. That's not what I said, actually. What I said, and I was crystal clear about it, is that the Prime Minister has helped Mr. Anil Ambani steal 30,000 crore rupees. And the House of the People, the Lok Sabha, is where the Prime Minister should have defended himself. The Prime Minister chose to send another person. That person happened to be a woman. I would have made a very similar comment if it had been a man. I would have just said, chose to send a man. Do not impose your sexism on me. Okay, I'm very clear. The Prime Minister should have delivered that defense. The Prime Minister did not have the guts to deliver the defense, and the Prime Minister ran away from the House of Parliament. That's simple as that. And by the way, the Raksha Mantri didn't deliver a defense either. There is a simple question that is being asked. Why did Mr. Anil Ambani get that contract? Why did he get 30,000 crores? And did anybody object to Mr. Narendra Modi bypassing the entire Indian Air Force? Yes or no? Simple question. Anybody can answer it. I haven't got the answer. The issue here is one of corruption. And that is the central point here.
Mr. Rahul, why don't you use Antony for professing your views on Rafael issue?
Why don't we?
Yeah, Antony was the defense minister.
Because
he could have got more clear picture on Rafael.
Maybe you're not watching TV, but Mr. Antony has done...
Only twice Antony come forward, I think.
No, that's not true. Mr. Antony has come again and again and again. Mr. Antony has made his views on Rafael absolutely crystal clear. And Mr. Antony is someone who we respect and who we think is extremely capable. It is simply not true that Mr. Antony is not raising the Rafael issue. He is.
Assalamu alaikum. اولا بالمستر غنجي بنرحب بيك في الامارات بلدك الثاني والسؤال بتاعي ما هو سبب الزياره والشق الثاني يوجد تعاون بين الامارات والهند منذ زمن طويل ما الجديد في التعاون خلال الفتره المقبله
Yeah, please.
There has been a long term cooperation between India and UAE. What is the new to this relation?
What is new to this relation?
Yeah.
This has been a very old relationship and a very successful relationship. It has been a relationship of mutual benefit, of tolerance, of love and affection. We have scaled many heights, and I think there is a lot of room for us to cooperate. You have done some very excellent work on education over here. You're doing some good work on healthcare. We also have our experiences in education and healthcare. In the financial sector, there is a lot that we can do together in cooperation against terrorism, defense. There is a lot of work that can be done. So it's an open canvas, and we are absolutely committed to improving and further strengthening the relationship between India and the UAE.
Mr. Gandhi,
it is also a relationship that is based on a similar vision.
Okay. Can I explain to her in Arabic?
Sorry?
Or shall I? Okay.
Sorry? Later. So it is based on similar ideas. The idea of tolerance, the year of tolerance, this is a central theme.
Okay. So the idea of tolerance that is being celebrated here in the form of the year of tolerance, this is a central theme in our country. We also believe in tolerance. We have always believed in tolerance. Of course, there is a little bit of an aberration going on back home where the BJP is being very aggressive, intolerant, and attacking and destroying our institutions. But this is a temporary blip which we will take care of after the 2019 election.
You have the largest population of Indians residing anywhere in the world, in the Gulf and in the UAE. This is Shayan Shikhi from Arabian Business. Is there a way you can get them to vote for the elections? Because they've been asking for that to be put on the manifesto. That's my first question. The second is, Imran Khan's making quite a few overtures to, you know, having talks with Narendra Modi, but nothing has come through that. Is that something you change? And third, is there a way you could get more businesses from the Gulf to, you know, have IPOs in India? Because right now they're exploring doing that in other parts of the world.
The third question first. Bringing big business to India is fundamentally connected to the environment in India. And in fact, I don't know if you've read the newspapers, but India is facing a 14-year low, I think, with regards to investment flows into India. And the central reason is a couple of ill-advised and badly thought out economic moves like demonetization and a poorly designed GST, and also the atmosphere that has been vitiated and spoilt. India is known for non-violence. India is known for its peace-loving nature. And when people look at India and see violence, they get worried. And so that is something that we are going to change. We will provide a peaceful environment. We will put an end to the division and the anger that is being spread by the BJP. And we will take some rational economic decisions. We will restructure the GST, and we will embrace investment from the Middle East and other parts of the world. So that's the first question. Second question about Pakistan. Look, I'm in the opposition. I'm not privy to the information the Prime Minister has. I will obviously act on the information when it is available to me. I'm all for peaceful relationship with Pakistan, but I will absolutely not tolerate violence being carried out against Indians, innocent Indians, by the Pakistani state. And that is the central issue here. You cannot carry out acts of terror in India and then expect India to talk kindly to you. The first question, sorry, what was it? I mean, that's unlikely to happen in this election because that would require legislation and a longer conversation. But it is something that I find to be an interesting idea. There is already some proxy voting that is allowed. But I think we are all for more representation for NRIs back home. The Prime Minister is currently being held hostage currently being held hostage by the Rafael scam. A person who has sacked the CBI chief twice in a row and is terrified to let the CBI chief sit there for 15 minutes has no business to talk about anything. He should explain to this country, to our country, why he handed 30,000 crores to Mr. Anil Ambani, why he sacked at night, and why then he threw a massive panic, tried to force Mr. Kharge to come within a couple of hours to sack him, and then eventually sacked him the next day without hearing the man. That's a very interesting question, and it's something the media should raise.
Rahulji.
Mr. Gandhi.
Rahulji. Mr. Rahulji, I'm Arun Singh, who news at in India.
You know, Arun ji.
अमेठी और रायबरेली दो सीटें ऐसी थी कि इस महागठबंधन ने छोड़ी है कांग्रेस के लिए. एक संकेत दिया है कि पोस्ट पोल अलायंस अभी भी ऑप्शन उसके खुले हुए हैं. क्या कांग्रेस पार्टी की तरफ से आपकी तरफ से भी इसी तरह का सिमिलर जेस्चर है कि आप आगे चल करके पोस्ट पोल अलायंस के लिए खुले हुए हैं?
मेरी पोजिशन बड़ी क्लियर है. मायावती जी ने और अखिलेश जी ने निर्णय लिया है, और मायावती जी का, मुलायम सिंह यादव, अखिलेश जी की मैं रिस्पेक्ट करता हूं, इज्जत करता हूं, और वो उनका पॉलिटिकल डिसीजन है, और उन्होंने सोच समझ के डिसीजन लिया होगा. अब कांग्रेस पार्टी को उत्तर प्रदेश में अपने आप को खड़ा करना है. वो हमारे ऊपर है, हम कैसे करें. मैं डायरेक्टली आपसे कहता हूं कि चुनाव तो हम पूरे दम लगा के लड़ेंगे, क्योंकि हमारी विचारधारा की लड़ाई है, आइडियोलॉजिकल लड़ाई है बीजेपी के साथ, और हम अपनी आइडियोलॉजी को उत्तर प्रदेश में फैला के ही रहेंगे. मगर उन्होंने निर्णय लिया है, एक प्रकार से कांग्रेस पार्टी के बारे में उन्होंने थोड़ा गलत भी बोला, मगर हम उसको एक्सेप्ट करते हैं, क्योंकि हम, ये हमारा तरीका है, हम प्यार से राजनीति करते हैं, मगर फिर हम अपनी जगह बनाएंगे.
Mr. Gandhi, you just said you wanted to create a peaceful environment and bring India back to that sort of tolerance that you've been discussing. But in terms of concrete, immediate steps, what would you do? And you also said you'd take rational economic decisions. What would be the priority in terms of those?
Priority number one would be job creation, where the current government is failing. We have massive unemployment problem. Mr. Narendra Modi demonetized the Indian currency, which is an unbelievably rash, irresponsible action. He was directly responsible for the decimation of the informal sector. He's imposed a five-layer GST. GST is supposed to be one tax, so it's not even really a GST. So we will correct the floor GST. We will rebuild trust in our institutions. It's the first time in Indian history that the chief of the RBI has resigned. You know, we will build confidence in institutions like the RBI, institutions like the Supreme Court, institutions like the Election Commission, which are under systematic attack. You must have heard about the CBI chief. The CBI chief wanted to investigate the Rafael scam. The Prime Minister fired him. The Supreme Court intervened. The Supreme Court said, you cannot fire him. And then in another fit, the Prime Minister fired him again. So it's pretty clear that he is strangling institutions. He is attacking the strength of India. And that is what we defend. We will allow the institutions to operate. We will not strangle them. We will not crush them. We will respect them, whether it is the RBI, whether it is the CBI, whether it is the Election Commission, whether it is the Supreme Court. And we will start to do what the Congress Party has successfully done since the 90s, which is put India on a economic path, a path of progress and a path of growth. I mean, I don't know if you've ever heard of another country that has actually changed the way they measure GDP to make their Prime Minister happy. I don't think another country has done it. I mean, if it has, maybe you can tell me about it, because India is one of the only countries that has actually changed the way they measure GDP to show the world that they're doing a better job than they actually are. Our party has a record. We're the party of liberalization. We're the party that provided the fastest economic growth India has ever had in the first decade of this century. So we know how to do that, and we're going to do it. At the end, it is about confidence. Mr. Modi's actions, whether they are his actions against institutions or his actions on the economy, have basically destroyed the confidence that Indian people have and that the international community has on Mr. Narendra Modi. And he's done it. I mean, he has done it himself. Rebuilding that trust and making people believe that India is a country that can actually deliver on employment, on job creation, on the economy.
Rahul ji, yahan pe. Rahul ji, Pranay Upadhyay, ABP News. Se. Mere do sawal hain aapse. Pehla to ye कि जिस राज्य से आप संसद पहुंचते हैं चुनके, उस राज्य में महागठबंधन की कोशिशों को झटका लगने के बाद, क्या आप अब भी स्थानीय स्तर पर गठबंधन बनाने की कोशिश करेंगे राज्यों में और अलग अलग, या तीन राज्यों में मिली जीत के बाद अब आप कांग्रेस को अकेले चुनाव के मैदान में ले जाने पर ज्यादा जोर देंगे? और दूसरा सवाल यह कि प्रधानमंत्री ने आज कहा कि चौकीदार अपना काम कर रहा है, इसलिए लोग गाली गलौज पर उतर रहे हैं, इस कॉमेंट का आप कैसे जवाब देंगे?
चौकीदार अपना काम कर रहा है, मतलब चौकीदार चोरी कर रहा है, कमाल का चौकीदार है, पूरा देश जानता है। और देखिए, मैं आपको बता रहा हूं, अभी शुरुआत हुई है, अभी ट्रेलर दिखा है, मगर राफेल की जो सच्चाई है, डीमोनेटाइजेशन की जो सच्चाई है, जैसे ही लोगों को वो सच्चाई दिखाई देगी, फिर चौकीदार की बात सुनेंगे, ठीक है? जहां, और वो होने वाला है, उससे कोई बच नहीं सकता, सच्चाई से कोई बच नहीं सकता है। प्रधानमंत्री जी सच्चाई से नहीं बच सकते हैं, सच्चाई उनको भी मालूम है। राफेल में उन्होंने क्या किया मालूम है, पूरे देश को मालूम है, और वो साबित हो जाएगा, मुझे कोई बोलने की जरूरत नहीं। यूपी का मैंने जवाब दे दिया, यूपी में गठबंधन हुआ है, उन्होंने निर्णय लिया है, उनकी चॉइस है, मगर अब हमें भी यूपी में एक्शन लेना है, हमें भी चुनाव स्ट्रेंथ से लड़ना है, एग्रेशन से लड़ना है, और वो हम करेंगे, और नतीजा लोगों को सरप्राइज करेगा।
सवाल मेरा यूपी पे लेकिन व्यापक महागठबंधन
बनाना। अच्छा, महा नहीं, अलग अलग स्टेट्स में अलग अलग सिचुएशन है। महाराष्ट्र में, तमिलनाडु में, झारखंड में, बिहार में, बाकी स्टेट्स में गठबंधन काफी इफेक्टिवली सील हो रहे हैं एक के बाद एक, तो वो प्रॉब्लम नहीं आएगी। उत्तर प्रदेश में मैं उसको सेटबैक नहीं कहूँगा, क्योंकि वो चाहे मायावती जी और मुलायम और अखिलेश जी अलायंस करें, चाहे हम तीनों एक साथ करें, बीजेपी की सीटें नहीं आने वाली वहां पे।
व्हाट इज द सॉल्यूशन फॉर राफेल डील इफ यू बिकम अ प्राइम मिनिस्टर? If you become a prime minister, what you will do? You'll scrap the deal?
No. Raphael deal. Look, the question is one of justice. What has happened in the Raphael deal is very clear. French president has said he was told by our prime minister to give the deal to Mr. Anil Ambani. This is unheard of. Unheard of. Mr. Anil Ambani has no experience in making aircraft. The entire Air Force, right up to the Defense Minister has publicly said, I have no idea about this new deal. So the first question in Raphael is justice. Justice for the Air Force, justice for HAL, and justice against the people who've stolen from the people of India. And it's pretty clear who those people are, there's no doubt.
So, Rahulji, I saw you represent the Telugu states here in Dubai. Can you please tell me, in the recent elections which has happened for the Telangana and Telangana, though the AICC committee have come all the way from Telangana to, you know, like introduce the NRI policy, which they want to, you know, introduce for the community here for the workers, though it has really received well with the community. But despite of having this policy being, you know, included into your manifesto, what is the thin line you think is have decided the victory for Telangana?
We haven't really analyzed Telangana in detail. Okay. But the difference in vote share, going into the election, between us and the TRS was actually quite substantial. Okay. So it was not an easy election to win. Okay. We did pretty well. We increased our vote share and we fought a pretty good election. Okay. But I think there was a significant gap there. Okay. But I haven't studied that in detail, and my team is studying that in detail.
Okay.
So we will decide and take action once we...
And regarding the Andhra, can we expect a special status for Andhra from you? So once
look,
you are
I committed in these three elections that we will do farm loan waivers in these three states in 10 days. And I delivered it in 2 days. I don't like telling lies. My name is not Mr. Narendra Modi. I don't like making false promises. I don't like saying that I'll give every Indian citizen 15 lakhs in his bank account. I don't like saying, you know, that I will create 2 crore jobs every year if I can't do it. I'm answering your question. So if you have heard it coming out of my mouth, I will do everything to deliver it. And I have committed to the people of Andhra that the moment we form the government in Delhi, we are going to deliver special status to Andhra. And I want to tell you why. We're going to deliver special status to Andhra because it is a commitment made by the Indian government, not any particular party, but the Indian Prime Minister, the post, to the state of Andhra Pradesh, which we are extremely proud of and which is a great state. So we are going to deliver that commitment to the people of Andhra Pradesh. It is a tragedy. And it is a shame that the Prime Minister of India is not delivering that commitment that is owed to the people of Andhra. We will do that.
Rahul sir, what's your personal stand? Sir, here, myself, Nishmelato from Amrita Television. I'm asking you personally, what is your personal stand on Sabarimala issue, not as a politician?
What is my personal stand? I mean, I've heard both the arguments. My initial position was different than my position today. After I've heard the arguments of the people of Kerala, I can see validity in both arguments. I can see validity in the argument that tradition needs to be protected, and I can see validity in the argument that women should have equal rights. So I wouldn't be able to tell you an open and shut, give you an open and shut position on this. And it is actually after I spoke to the people of Kerala, the PCC and the team in Kerala, that they explained to me the details of it, where I said, okay, actually this is much more complicated. And both sides have a valid position. I think I leave it to the people of Kerala to decide. That's what I told my unit over there, that look, you know, we leave it to you. You have to decide what the will of the people of Kerala is.
But in this case, Sabarimala case, Supreme Court verdict is that they are allowing entry to the Sabarimala. That's Supreme Court verdict is imposing by the government.
I mean, it's obviously I'm not going to comment on a decision taken by the Supreme Court of our country. I mean, that is not my place.
Is there the duty of the government to implement the Supreme Court verdict? That is the case.
It's not my place to comment on it. I cannot sit here and comment on what the Supreme Court of India has decided. It's not my place.
Okay, now another question. In your speech, I saw a speech in, I think it's America, that he was telling that constitutional institutions are destroying by the government of India. And now we see the CBI And do you intend this constitutional institution like election commission and also Supreme Court? You are intending the Supreme Court also?
You're sorry, what?
Institutional, that constitutional institution are destroying by the government of, that is, Modi. And you are referring to election commission and the education system also.
I am referring to every single institution in India. The idea of the BJP and the RSS is that there should only be one institution in India, and that's called the RSS. And they insert their people in every single institution and they pressure every single institution. So I'm talking about every single institution, Indian institution. Universities, colleges, election commission, CBI, ED, every institution. It's their nature. When the Congress party looks at an institution, they see the voice of the people of India. They respect that. They say, we're not going to try and influence this. When the Congress party sees the Supreme Court, they say, this is an institution, asset of the people of India. We respect it. Even though sometimes we might disagree with what they do. They might attack us, or they might be like, okay, this is the voice of the people. We're not going to touch it. That's not how the RSS thinks. The RSS thinks that the voice of the people is irrelevant. It is the voice of the Sangh that is important. And so they try to put the voice of the Sangh in every single institution. And one of the reasons we're going to win the election in 2019 is that there is a massive, massive response coming from Indian institutional structures. There's a massive response coming from bureaucrats, from the institutional structures, from the people of India that is saying, we are not going to accept this. We are not going to accept you destroying the CBI. We're not going to accept you destroying the Supreme Court. We're not going to accept an India where Supreme Court judges are sitting in front and saying we're not being allowed to do work. And this is coming from the heart of India. So you're going to see, you're going to have a shocking result in 2019. Mr. Modi will not understand what has happened because he has fiddled with India's voice. He has tried to suppress India's voice. And he's done it to try and help his friend, Mr. Anil Ambani. Anyway, thank you very much for... Okay, last question.
9 months over, forming a coalition government in Karnataka. It seems all is not well in between JDS and Congress. Apart from all other blame games, Karnataka new government failed to appoint new deputy chairman for Karnataka NRA Forum.
I'm in touch with...
You are known for taking rapid action. So for new deputy chairman for Karnataka NRA Forum...
I'm disagreeing with what you're saying. Look, when you're running a coalition government, little bit of issues always arise. But the fundamentals of the government in Karnataka are absolutely solid. They are having a very decent conversation among themselves, the Congress party and the JDS. And this idea that you're mentioning is just simply not true. The government is actually working pretty well.
NRI from Karnataka need a deputy chairman for Karnataka NRI Forum. It's pending from last 9 months. Can you take action on this?
Okay, you've told me. Let me take a look at it.
Thank you.
I'm taking back the spirit of our community. I'm taking back the love and affection of the people of the UAE. And I'm taking back the idea that India's diaspora is a very, very powerful asset for our country and needs to be embraced and fully utilized, needs to be treated with love and affection. That's what I'm taking back. And I'm also taking back the idea that I've seen here in Dubai of tolerance, of living together, working together. That is an Indian idea that is being attacked in our own country. So it's been a very nice visit for me. I have been shown huge amount of love and affection by our Indian community and by the local people. I've been made to feel like part of the family, and I thank everybody in Dubai and in UAE
for that. People have come from other parts of the Gulf. People have come from Egypt. People have come from Saudi Arabia. People have come from all sorts of other countries. So I thank you for coming. And I thank you very much for the affection you've shown me. And I want to tell you that great things are going to happen in India. We've had a temporary blip. We are going to move forward. And we're going to take on the challenges. And we're going to do it working with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, friends.